Wherever we gather on holy ground. Our church building stands on native lands in what is now Santa Fe, but which in Tewa is called Ogabake. From wherever you join us, it is likely that you too abide on land taken from the indigenous people. We acknowledge this painful past, and we see this as an important step toward reconciliation. Good morning and welcome. My name is Mai Britt. My pronouns are she, her, and hers, and I'm the worship associate today. Thank you for joining us this morning. If it is your first time and you haven't yet introduced yourself in the chat, we hope you do, because we appreciate knowing you are here today or virtually, and so extend our circle of belonging. If you have a joy or a sorrow to share with the community, email it now to joysandsorrows@uusantafe.org, and we'll share it all together later in the service. Sometimes our stream gets interrupted, but have patience, log back on, and we'll get back on track as quickly as we can.
We gather in a house of stories, a shelter shot through with memories that speak, that long for us to listen, and without which we easily lose our way. As we learn of those who have gone before, the way in front of us becomes clear. As we attune ourselves to the many, many shoulders on which we stand, purpose, not want, or winning, asserts itself as the logic of our lives. As we remember what our predecessors survived and how they sacrificed for the faceless us who would come after, we find a courage far beyond what we could muster on our own. Beneath the seemingly dry dirt and the seemingly lonely roads, there are wells from which we can drink. Come, let those sweet ghosts whisper their gifts. Come, let us drink from the web of memories that sustains us all.
Our chalice words are adapted from Friedrich Nietzsche on the Use and Abuse of History, 1874. To be sure, we need history, but we need it for life and action. We wish to use history only insofar as it serves the living. To set oneself down on the crest of the moment, to forget everything from the past, to stand on a single point, is to believe in the power of one's own being.
Let us kindle our chalice for stories that serve the living and build a better world for those who are yet to come.
Interpretation 4000.
Good morning, and welcome to the Yew Tree House in Santa Fe. I'm Stephen Mead, and friends, here to tell another story this morning that we can have fun with and learn something from. Today's story comes out of the book Hide and Seek with God, by Mary Ann Moore, published by Skinner House Press. This is called God Has Many Names. Once upon a time, a girl and a boy played with each other and argued with each other. And sometimes they argued about who could swing the highest, and sometimes they argued about whose cookie was the biggest, and one time, they were arguing about God's real name. The girl said, God's real name is the mother of us all. The boy said, no, it isn't. God's real name is Father in Heaven. No, the girl said, it's Mother. It's not, the boy said, it's Father. I have an idea, said the girl. Let's go find God and ask her what her real name is. And then we'll know for sure, and you'll see that I am right. Okay, agreed the boy. I think that's a very good idea. And when we find God, he will tell you that his real name is Father. So, the boy and the girl, they set off to find God. And even though both of them admitted they were a bit afraid to go too far from home, and they might be afraid to talk to God as well. And after they had gone some distance, they met people carrying food home from the market. And they said to these people, we are looking for God so that we can find out what God's real name is. Well, one of the people said, I think if you go straight down that road, you will find God. But I can tell you that God's real name is Giver of Life. Well, the children thanked the people, but told them they still wanted to find God and ask for themselves. And the people offered children bread and fruit, and they continued on. So they came to a river where people were fishing from a boat, and they asked them where they could find God so that they could find out God's real name. And the people told them they would have to cross the river to find God. But one of the people says, well, you really don't have to go across because we know God's real name is the Hidden One. But if you still want to go on, we will give you a ride to the other side of the river. So the children thanked them and crossed the river and continued on. The boy and the girl were beginning to get tired as they approached another group of people in a grove of trees. We want to find out God's real name. Do you know where we can find God? The boy and girl asked. Well, you may find God if you go a little deeper into the forest, one of them said. But it isn't necessary. I can tell you God's real name. It's Protector. Well, we still want to find out for ourselves, the children said. Well, I'll take these blankets for your journey, the people replied. And the children thanked them and traveled deeper into the forest. Night came, and the girl and the boy ate the bread and the fruit, lay in the blankets under the trees to sleep. So when morning came, just as the sun was peeping through the trees, they heard a kindly voice say, I understand that there are children here who want to know my real name. That's right, we do, they cried together. Are you afraid? The girl whispered to her friend. No, said the boy. Are you? I'm not either, the girl said. That sounds kind of friendly. Well, what do you think my real name is? Asked God. Well, I think it's the mother of all, said the girl. And so it is. See, said the girl happily, I was right. Well, said the boy disappointed, I thought it was Father in Heaven. And so it is, said God again. See, I'm happy now, I was right. Wait a minute, the girl said, thinking hard. How can we both be right? And what about those people we met on the trip who said your name was Giver of Life and Hidden One and the Protector? What about them? They are right too, said God. But how can you have more than one real name? Asked the boy. Doesn't one of them have to be the real name or the only right name? No, said God, I have many names. Some people say I have 99 names, and some people say I have thousands of names. Well, what are some of the 99 names? The girl asked. Well, there's Giver of Life and Hidden One and Protector. Those are three of them, God replied. Some others are Truth, the Creator, the Loving One, and of course, the 100th name is Allah. What are some of the thousands of names? Asked the boy. Mother of all, and Father in Heaven, and Shiva, the Great Spirit, Gaia, and any of these names is my real name, if the person who calls me by them does it with a loving heart, God explained. Well, my heart feels loving when I call you Mother of All, said the girl. And my heart feels loving when I call you Father in Heaven, said the boy. Then, Mother of All is my real name to you, God said to the girl. And Father in Heaven is my real name for you, God said to the boy. And the girl and the boy thanked God for helping them to understand this. And they went home, and they argued about who'd been the bravest. They didn't argue anymore about God's real name.
Wars have been fought, and people have died over which name of God is the real name, over whose story is the story that is true. You see, stories matter. The stories we hear, the stories we read, these and the stories we tell script our lives and help us make sense of this world we live in, at least as our culture understands it. God's stories are interesting because they define our individual connection to the cosmos. They tell us where we fit in the greatest scheme of things and what or who we should be honoring. Interestingly, though, different story frames lead to different ways of behaving. If we understand God as a judging Father in Heaven, we may behave quite differently than if we understand God as our loving Abba. If we understand God as Goddess and Mother of All, or as Mother Nature, we may treat other people and the natural world differently than if we understand God as a human projection on the cosmos, or as a figment of someone's imagination. What stories about God shape your understanding of who you are? And where did you learn them? Not only do we rely on stories to tell us what the cosmos is like and how we are related to it, we also find our own identities in the stories our culture offers us. Before we're even aware of what is happening, stories teach us what is possible for people like us. That's why there's this big kerfuffle going on over Big Bird getting a vaccine, right? Because children absorb that story that says, I'm like Big Bird. And so what is good for Big Bird is probably good for me. Our stories tell us what is allowed or expected of girls and boys, for Anglo folk or Latinx, for people who are in wheelchairs and those who are able-bodied. And all too often, we accept the stories we are told as the way the world is, without ever thinking about it. And we choose one of the multiple choice options those stories offer us, never thinking there might be other ways that we could be in the world. So if our stories say you can be a teacher or a mother, a hero or a businessman, a princess or a pauper, you can be religious or secular, we accept that. And it limits, quite often, what we think is possible for us and for others. Our stories are everywhere. They get told in books and movies, TV shows and commercials, social media and person to person. And they're so powerful and mutually reinforcing that it's very, very difficult most of the time for us to step out of our cultural story. Another word that's often used for story is paradigm or worldview. And changing our worldview or our paradigm is desperately difficult. This is partly because when the stories that underpin our personal worldview are challenged, we feel like our world is falling apart. We don't know what's true. We are unsure how we are supposed to behave. That's one of the reasons there's so much pushback around vaccines and critical race theory and the new social study curricula and all kinds of behavior that are necessary to mitigate and adapt to climate change. These challenges and the stories we tell about them somehow contradict some part of the larger cultural view that many of us inherited. I like the Marianne Moore story that Stephen told about the many names of God. By allowing for multiple names for a single reality, Moore diffuses some of the tension in the story. But we have to remember, it's only possible for her to do that because she, as a Unitarian Universalist, has already stepped outside of the frame that says only one story can be true. And so I ask, what stories do you inhabit? Are your stories being challenged? And how does that challenge feel when it happens? Amen. Every Sunday, we pause in our service to listen to the small, profound stories that are shaping our lives. The birth of a grandchild, the illness of a beloved, the visit of a dear friend, the publication of a book, all of these things shape our day-to-day. The joys in the stories are multiplied in the telling. And the burdens of our sorrows are eased. So would you light a first candle for a joy that Rick and Judy Cormier are with us this Sunday to provide the wonderful drumming? And another joy. We are moving slowly in fits and starts towards resettling Afghan refugee and asylee families here in Santa Fe. And UU Santa Fe is going to be partnering, at least to begin with the Northern New Mexico Unitarian Universalist. So we will partner with Los Alamos and with Taos in hosting a family here in Santa Fe. And if you want to know more, stay tuned or touch base with Gail Wasserman. I have a sorrow I need to put in before, or a concern before I read the stack that are here. In our time, our lives are permeated with lots of different stories about COVID-19. Some of them contradict each other. But the new story this week is that about 28% of the new COVID-19 cases here in New Mexico are among vaccinated individuals, as are about 23% of the hospital admissions. We are riding on another surge caused by the Delta variant and waning immunity among those of us who are vaccinated. So if you were vaccinated 6 months ago, your immunity has dropped. You need to get a booster. That's the way to stay safe, friends. State of New Mexico is making it very easy to get a booster. There are pop-up tents all over the place. Go to the farmer's market, walk up, they'll put you in the computer, even if you forgot your COVID-19 card. So I can talk to you this morning without my mask, partly because you're wearing masks, but partly because I got my booster shot last week. As Unitarian Universalists, we follow the science. And the science is telling us we need to be careful once again. I'm meeting with our COVID task force this week, and there will be, once again, new COVID safe guidelines for our congregation, probably starting for December 1st. We have been so fortunate. No one in our immediate community has been lost to COVID. You are irreplaceable, my friends. I do not want to have to light a candle and find a white rose for any of you. So, you are sitting in the midst of about half of the books that were here on Thursday for the book sale. And we have a thank you to everyone who made our books, arts, and crafts sale a success. The donors, the over 50 volunteers, that's 50 people, not people over 50. The 50 people who volunteered and the enthusiastic shoppers. We will exceed $4,000 in revenue, which is the highest in the history, I think, of our book sale. The book sale team who writes this is Cheryl Ansel and Roberta Armstrong, Gail Boyd, Ann Jennings Reed, Rod Morgan, and Karen McGrath. We have a warm welcome to Gwen Pinkham, who is a long-distance member who has joined. She's in Helena, Montana. Hello, Gwen. I hope you're seeing this today. And we have a joy. Mary Nykirk writes, this morning I successfully spent two 15-minute sessions in my office organizing paperwork. It has been an ongoing project since 2019. Yay for progress. We have a request from Catherine Holliday that we light a candle for Todd Bailey, 49 years of age, a journalist in Santa Fe and Hobbs. Todd was like a godfather to my grandsons and a close and longtime friend to their mom. I hope you're finding a paper to edit out there somewhere, Todd. And then we have birthdays. This week, April Gifford, Mim Chapman, and Sandy Bays celebrate birthdays. Happy birthday to you all. All right. So, since we have lit candles, let's listen together to Spirit of Life. Thank you. resting on the echoes of the music, let us move into a time of quiet reflection and contemplation. I invite you to take a breath and close your eyes if that is comfortable for you. And to, as you exhale, to feel your body relax. Breathe. And let your breath be easy and effortless. Breathe. And let your mind quiet and your thoughts drift. Breathe. And feel your heart begin to soften and to open until it can cradle all the stories, all the confusion and complexity and wonder and joy that are a part of being human in this world. Breathe. And feel yourself cradled by the affection and regard of this community. Breathe. And as we rest together in the quiet, I wonder, did you spend any time this past week watching the twilight come? Did you sit and let the night creep in and roll over you before you turned on a light? Did you stare out the window and watch the lights come on in your neighborhood? What did that darkness feel like? Was it beautiful? Boring? Terrifying, complicated. What stories did you tell yourself as you sat in the dark and watched night fall?
In her novel, Half of a Yellow Sun, about the birth of an African nation, Biafra, Chimamanda Adichie warns us that you can love someone or something and still be condescending, that he who defines the person regulates the relationship, so that we can choose who we are, despite the identity others would put upon us, that our projections as to other people's worth tend to be upended, as in the novel, The Small Igbo Serving Boy authors the book, "The World Was Silent When We Died." Listen now to an excerpt from Chimamanda Adichie's TED Talk, The Danger of a Single Story. When I left Nigeria to go to the university in the United States, I was 19. My American roommate was shocked by me. She asked where I had learned to speak English so well, and was confused when I said Nigeria happened to have English as its official language. She asked if she could listen to what she called my tribal music, and was consequently very disappointed when I produced my tape of Mariah Carey. She assumed I did not know how to use a stove. What struck me was this. She had felt sorry for me even before she saw me. Her default position toward me as an African was a kind of patronizing, well-meaning pity. My roommate had a single story of Africa, a single story of catastrophe. In this single story, there was no possibility of Africans being similar to her in any way. No possibility of feelings more complex than pity. No possibility of a connection as human equals. Power is the ability not just to tell the story of another person, but to make it the definitive story of that person. The Palestinian poet Murad Barghouti writes that if you want to dispossess a people, the simplest way to do it is to tell their story and to start with, secondly, start the story with the arrows of the Native Americans and not with the arrival of the British, and you have an entirely different story. Start the story with the failure of the African state and not with the colonial creation of the African state, and you have an entirely different story.
What if we could accept multiple stories about the nature of our world and our reality as easily as we Unitarian Universalists accept multiple names for God? As UUs, we've long acknowledged multiple theological and atheological narratives as legitimate sources of insight and wisdom. And we study other people's holy books, and we buy them, and we put them in our libraries, and mostly we delight in the ways these perspectives broaden our understanding of what it means to be human and how we might live well and happily in the world. What would it be like if we could do that with other kinds of stories, especially the ones that challenge us? What if we could do it with stories about, let's see, history, which I think is over there, and economics, and technology, and medicine, and education, and psychology, and gender, and race? I wonder, if we were to sort through the books that remain from our book sale, the books that are stacked here in the room this morning, how many of them would tell stories that reinforced that old hierarchical, privileged, patriarchal, white way of seeing? And how many of them would elaborate parts of the dominant story reinforcing the way things are? And how many of them would be critiques? How many would be alternatives? How many would be genuinely new stories or untold parts of existing stories related by characters who were missing from the more usual narratives? When I read religious texts from other traditions, I often consciously use our UU principles as a sifting tool, helping me to decide what is useful and what is not. I do this with intention because, you know, I know I've chosen this particular lens that's defined in our principles when I chose to become a Unitarian Universalist. I'm aware that it's not the only worldview, but it is one that I find life-affirming and life-sustaining. If the text that I'm reading undermines any of our UU principles, it suggests that only one story is true, or that only one group gets to define which stories are told. If it contradicts that fourth principle of valuing the free and responsible search for truth and meaning, I try to understand why, and then I try to figure out what to do with it. And often I choose not to use that narrative in our worship gatherings or in any of our study groups, unless I can figure out how to contextualize it so we understand why it is the way it is, and build a bridge so we can talk to people who might understand that point of view. The same strategy of sifting with our Unitarian Universalist principles, I think, might be helpful in reading any of the texts gathered here today. We just have to remember that we're doing it. After I found, or when I don't find, a particular message, I go looking for those voices that I think are missing. Often I will go looking for other voices and other stories, and sometimes what we do, rather than offering a single alternative story to the main narrative in which we live, we'll offer multiple alternative stories. I can remember a friend talking about how you locate the good fishing hole at the lake. In northern Minnesota, you do not put a buoy out there with a flag on it that says the big fish are here. What you do is you sit in your boat where the big fish are and you look to the shore on this side. Okay, I line myself up with the big tree. And you look to the shore there or over here, and you say, okay, it's right by the bluff. And where those two points of view intersect, you know there's treasure. Big fish. We can do the same with literature, and we often do with stories. We take a story from over here and a story from over there, and when they come into connection, when they intersect, we can be pretty sure we're going to discover something new, interesting, maybe challenging. This time of year, our congregation will acknowledge Hanukkah and Yule and Kwanzaa and the scientific creation narrative and the Christmas story. By placing all these stories in juxtaposition, we have a sense that each of them might give us a little bit of the truth, but none of them offers all of it. We remember there are many stories told in midwinter. And when we tell lots of them, we avoid that single narrative danger. We avoid projecting on someone else. Again, we can do this with history, with economics, with just about anything, with novels. Perhaps part of what we need to do is modeled by a Jewish practice called Midrash. Midrash are commentaries and stories that are created to fill in the gaps of accepted narratives. And so in the story of Adam and Eve, you might have another narrative created from the point of view of the snake or the Tree of Knowledge. You might have a story created by, oh, I don't know, Lilith watching over the wall and looking into the garden. If we were looking at or for Midrash, we would be looking for stories that offer different perspectives than the one we expect. Narratives from unheard points of view and honest critique. And if you go to the website for Beacon Press, our Unitarian Universalist publishing house, and look at what they publish, I think they follow this practice. There is a great number of there are a great number of authors who represent these different points of view, critiquing and balancing the stories we maybe grew up with. And then there are our personal stories, because we have stories too. The stories aren't just out there in the world. We're embedded in our culture's history in lots of different ways. Some of us are recent immigrants. Some of us are descendants of colonizers. Some of us are descendants of indigenous people who were colonized. And I wonder how many of us have family stories that we maybe don't always share. You know, the part that was at one point cause for pride and maybe now leaves us feeling a little conflicted. The part that was once reason for pain and grief, but it now, with the shifting of our culture, is reason for solidarity and pride. On my dad's side of the family, there was a tradition for women in the family to write their autobiographies. And so we have a number of autobiographies of my dad's maternal ancestors going back. One of the first accounts is of one of my great-great-grandmothers participation in the settling of the Anderson Lakes area in Shakopee, Minnesota, which is near Minneapolis. And she tells of coming up the Mississippi River on a boat and then crossing the prairie on a prairie schooner. And, you know, as a kid, I loved the stories. You know, this was Laura Ingalls Wilder, but it was in my family. There are a number of stories that she tells that are about interactions with the Native Americans. I haven't gone back to read them recently. I wonder if they would look different from where we stand now. Nathaniel's family, my husband's family, goes back to the Mayflower. We have primary sources, letters and journals from a number of his various ancestors. Some of those stories are troubling in a contemporary context. All of them are amazingly human. Come February, Dave Wyman and myself and several others in the congregation are going to be shaping a service about the way our smaller family stories shape and are shaped by the larger cultural narratives in which they are embedded. The service will be a launch for a deeper exploration of the consequences of ancient documents on our contemporary culture. That will be an adult program series. If you have a family story about our shared cultural past, you know, particularly around settler colonialism or the doctrine of discovery, maybe you had ancestors who were colonizers or who were colonized, who were slaves or slaveholders or abolitionists. We'd like to hear those stories. So please let me or Dave know. Some of our history, individually and as a community, is bright, and some of our history is shadowed. To understand the fullness of our inheritance, the dark stories and the bright stories, is to be free to move in the world in a wiser and more appropriate way. Unitarian religious educator Sophia Foss has a reading, and I'm going to do a sort of loose adaptation. The reading is, "It matters what we believe." I would offer, It matters which stories we tell. It matters which stories we tell, because some stories are like walled gardens. Some stories encourage exclusiveness and the feeling of being especially privileged, whereas there are other stories that are expansive and lead the way to wider and deeper sympathy. Some stories tell us about the shadows, the things that cloud our days. They spark fears of unknown calamity, whereas other stories serve as sunshine, blessing us with the warmth of happiness and shining light into the dark corners. Some stories we tell are divisive. They separate those who are saved from those who are not saved, those who are red from those who are blue, those who are friends, and those who are enemies. Other stories encourage us to understand the world as a community, where sincere differences beautify the pattern. Some stories function like blinders, shutting off the power to choose our own direction, whereas other stories are gateways, opening wide vistas into our commonality, into our shared worlds. Some stories undermine our sense of selfhood. They blight the growth of our resourcefulness. Some stories tell us other people have no selfhood, that they cannot be resourceful. But there are stories that nurture our self-confidence, that enrich our feeling of worth, that remind us that many stories can be true. Some stories are pliable, like young saplings. When we listen to those stories, we reach upward, growing with continuing life. It matters which stories we tell, which stories we read, which stories we listen to. And we get to choose. So next time you pick up a book, ask yourself, will this book cement my biases? Will it reinforce the dominant cultural narrative which surrounds me? Or will it challenge my perceptions, deepen my compassion, and widen my world? You know which books to choose. May it be so.
This month, we turn our generous impulses towards Peace Place, a homeless shelter that Unitarian Universalist Santa Fe helped found over a decade ago. So we're asking now and for the balance of the month, donations for Peace Place. And by the way, the bins are now moved near the kitchen in the hallway. And we're asking for new toiletries and warm clothing to go into the bins. You can think of such items as toothbrushes, travel size toothpaste, hand cream, travel size deodorant, band-aids, antibacterial ointment, massive disposable razors, Kleenex tissues, combs, lip balm, sunscreen, bars of soap, shampoo, foot powder, and of course, we appreciate your generosity to UU Santa Fe.
You know, I always wonder, what are the stories of the people who receive these gifts we gather and send their direction?
That's so much fun. So we're ready to extinguish our chalice. We extinguish our chalice flames, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fires of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again.
And we use those heart flames to kindle fires of truth, commitment, and community throughout the week until we can come together again. Not everyone is going to have the chance to travel to family this Thanksgiving. And even if we do, we may need to celebrate online as well, or in smaller gatherings. Friendsgivings, that's the topic of our next service. Friendsgivings are gatherings of friends to give thanks for one another and to honor the importance of chosen family in our lives, as well as the importance of kin. Next week's service will invite you to gather your friends together for conversation and storytelling and toasts. And so before we get there, I'd like you to start thinking about who you're already planning to gather with and who else you might want to thank and celebrate. Would you join me now for our hand-holding benediction? The words are adapted from UU chaplain Kate Braestrup. Go ahead, grab hands with someone if you're comfortable. Please stay seated. May love and skill be in our hands.
May love and skill be in our hands.
May love and courage fill our hearts.
May love and courage fill our hearts.
May love and wisdom light our minds.
May love and wisdom light our minds.
May love flow through us and walk among us.
May love flow through us and walk among us.
As we live our lives and work to heal our world.
As we live our lives and work to heal our world.
Amen, shalom, namaste, blessed be. Assalamu alaikum, ashe, oho. And now before you move, we have one more drum interlude. And if you would like to clap or drum on your thighs or pound on the table and be part of the music, I'm pretty sure that with Rick's background as a community drum circle leader, he would be just fine with that.
Two quick announcements. One is, this is an Acadian flag, in case anyone was wondering.
Acadian, yes.
Acadian.
Thank you for joining us today, friends. We hope that you enjoyed today's service. Please take a little time and explore our website and visit our online welcome table if you'd like to know more about us. Otherwise, we'll see you next Sunday morning. Stay in touch and be well.